Okay, sounds good. We are ready to call the meeting to order. This is the November 2nd meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Wintrow.
Here.
Asklund.
Yes.
Sims.
Here.
Hausch.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Also present are Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zant, and the Village Solicitor Chris Conard, and I see Chief Hale at the back of the room.
First, we have announcements. Any announcements?
Yeah, Patty, I just thought we should move up to the beginning of the meeting the announcement about Coffee with a Cop.
Absolutely. At the recommendation of the suggestion of Kate Hamilton from HRC, and in coordination with the Human Resources Commission, we are having Coffee with a Cop. This is the first of several events that we hope to have. It's Wednesday, November 11th from 5:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the Emporium, Dino's, and the Spirited Goat. There will be off-duty officers there. You can sit down, have a cup of coffee with them, talk to them, just get to know them a little bit. So please attend and meet some of the officers.
So there's going to be a different officer at each place?
There will.
Place. Oh,
and then
cool.
Chief and I will be like floating between the three locations.
And what's the time?
It's from 5:30 to 7 on Wednesday, November 11th.
Okay, great. Thank you. Anything else? Okay. Moving on to the consent agenda, the minutes of October 5th meeting. Do I have a motion for approval?
So moved.
I have a question.
Then we will need to remove it from the consent agenda.
If I have to see if I can remember what the question was. Never mind. I will consent to it. I can.
Okay. Will you second?
Yes, I'll second.
Okay, thank you. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next is a review of the agenda. We have a very packed amount of legislation on the agenda, but I actually think it may go quite quickly. Is there anything we want to move around or change or add?
There is one addition, which, sorry, Marianne. We have some nominations for the Economic Sustainability Commission that I would like to do tonight.
We'll add that under new business, and I also think we decided at the meeting on Thursday night that we would discuss what our schedule will be for the next steps for the ACE Task Force decision.
So will that be under old business?
I guess it could be. I mean, I put it under new business, but it probably should be under old business.
Okay.
Anything else?
I guess I forgot. I was going to announce that this, if the charter amendments do not pass, this may be my last meeting. So you know that. Otherwise, I'm on till the end of the year. We had to look at a lot of things to get this,
yeah.
Get this clarified.
And it's, I feel particularly bad because I wasn't even thinking it. So I don't feel prepared to say goodbye, and I don't want to say goodbye.
Well,
so
I'll try to plan to come on the third meeting.
Good, good.
Just regardless.
Great. That would be great.
It would be nice to have a more formal going away. So I'll be here one way or another. I'll be here.
Petitions and communications. There weren't any in the packet that I can see. There were a couple. We did receive a couple. But they were yesterday and today, I believe, so those will be in the minutes or in the packet for the next meeting. Both were in regard to the ACE Task Force discussion. So we'll move on to this hefty list of public hearings and legislation. I suggest we read them all by title only. Any objections? Okay. Second reading and public hearing of Ordinance 2015-14.
This is repealing old section 1046.02 service charges, exemption of chapter 1046, water of Title IV Public Utilities, Part 10 Streets, Utilities, and Public Services of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1046.02 service charges exemption.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So I move.
Second.
Thank you. I will turn this over to the village manager to take a few minutes to describe.
Actually, when we divvied up the ordinances and resolutions, Melissa was going to take this one, so.
I get this one. Okay, so the changes are a result of Wayne Cannon's presentation for RCAP that was held a couple of meetings ago. This is a 30% increase, which will take effect January 1st, and this is just for the consumption charges and not the readiness for service charges.
And could you describe the increases over the next 5 years and point out how we changed the ordinance to ensure that we carried it for 5 years?
Yes, this is going to be an ordinance that will cover increases based on RCAP's recommendations over the course of the next 5 years in conjunction with his, a rate study that he did. Sorry, exact title. So what we have for the water is we have 30% for the first 3 years, and then it's 2.25% for the next 2 years rate increases.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments or questions from council?
Does it also set in place that there'll be a plan to always have a small rate increase thereafter? I think it doesn't, right? So it's
no, it just no. Ended with the rate increase effective January 1st of 2020.
Okay. I think what happens over time is that councils forget that they need to keep an eye on this. And we have so much, we've had over the last many years so much turnover, and that's been part of the problem, is we went a very long time in our water without any rate increases, which just left us in a position where we couldn't afford to build or really fully maintain our water plant. And we started paying a lot more attention to this in 2010, but even that was probably a little bit too little too late. So I just point out that there is an expectation that there will always be it's better if for consumers and for everybody, for the village, to have a plan where there'll be a small rate increase, 1 or 2% every year, to keep up with inflation and to keep investing in the system so that you have a fund buildup that can then support whatever maintenance or capital investments you might need to make into your utilities.
Yeah. In Wayne's report, he did include recommendations out to year 10. So that document is part of was part of council packets, and that document.
Right.
Was
and what was,
I'm just,
was
I'm just worried
standard?
About 5 years from now.
Right.
we'll put notices in our electronic calendars that will remind us several months ahead of time, mm-hmm. so that we can bring it back to council once these expire. That's how we do most of those things.
Mm-hmm. And hopefully, if there's staff turnover, those will be. Staff turnover, software turnover. There's just a lot of places where things can get lost.
Right.
Any other comments, questions? This is a second reading and a public hearing. I will open for public comments. Please come up to the microphone and state your name and keep your comments to 3 minutes. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Asplund.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes. Next is second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2015-17.
Okay, this is repealing old section 1048.05, service charges of chapter 1048, sewers and sewage of title 4, public utilities, part 10, streets, utilities, and public services of the codified ordinances of the village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1048.05, service charges.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I have a feeling that this will be Melissa's mm-hmm. task to explain again.
So this was part two of Wayne Cannon and RCAP's rate study that they did for us. He did water and sewer in the same report. So these were based on his recommendations. It's 15% for the next 4 years, starting with January 1st, 2016, and then 3% in year 5, and then he did recommend it be 3% out till year 10. The only other change, there was no change to the readiness for service, I will note that. The only other change was there was a paragraph that we decided to strike through. It was H, and it was just some old language talking about rate increases or bonds issued to pay for improvements for the wastewater plant. So it was just old language that we just cleaned up and just struck out. So that was the only other change.
And just to be clear, this particular, this ordinance does not include an increase past year five.
No.
It was just recommended in the report.
Yes.
This will be in the same category that Lori described.
Correct.
It's the water plant, something that needs to be on a future agenda for council and staff.
Yeah, and it occurs to me, I love the idea, of course, of an electronic reminder, but why can't we start some sort of best practices folder? And it can just be simple references to things like this report, so you don't have to dig into 100 pages. Mm-hmm. And you know, it seems like that could live, you know, in a front file.
Mm-hmm. We're just such a small place, and there can be institutional memory loss if we have turnover, if there was an illness, or you know, anything that where both council and staff are significantly different in 6 years. I agree. I think having it in a couple of places would be really good.
Yeah, I like that institutional knowledge folder or whatever. That's
it will be a very thick folder, I have a feeling. So I think that there will probably be hundreds of pages in that too.
That's okay.
Maybe we need a little robot.
This is a second reading, and we will have a public hearing. I'll open the public hearing for comments. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asklin?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next is the first reading and public hearing, or excuse me, are we doing, is this an emergency?
No.
No?
It is not.
So first reading of ordinance 2015-19.
Adopting Chapter 881 of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs regarding municipal income tax, effective January 1, 2016.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
If you all recall from something that Chris brought to us at the last meeting, this is a and also Melissa, this is language that Rita, the Regional Income Tax Agency, and the Ohio Municipal League is recommending that we add. I think we have to add it in order to be in compliance with House Bill 5. One of you want to give more information than that?
That's really what it is. We're complying with the mandates of the state legislature.
And this is 881, Chapter 881. Chapter 880 will still remain into effect because of collections and withholdings that would have occurred prior to this going into effect. So they kind of have to work in parallel until we've got a couple of years under our belt where they're no longer collecting those prior years. So we have to have both of them working together, at least for the next few years. So that's why this is a totally new chapter.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments or questions? Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Asklund?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next is first reading of ordinance 2015-20.
This is repealing old Chapter 288, Public Art Commission of Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administrative Code of Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 288, Arts and Culture Commission.
Okay, thank you. Could I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. I think I'll, should we have Brian talk about this since it's his commission? I think this was his recommendation.
Sure. So I think, you know, I look back at the history of our process of standardizing our commission ordinances, and we started in 2014, actually. But, you know, through this process, we have basically looked at what are sort of the best practices out of all of the ordinances that we currently have, and standardizing most of that. And then the other piece is capturing all the specific things about each commission. And when we moved over, all the things that are unique to each commission have stayed in those ordinances. With regards to Public Arts Commission, we thought that based on what the role of the commission actually has been, that arts and culture made a lot more sense in terms of projects like the skate park, for example, that aren't art-specific. But otherwise, this is one of all the ordinances that we're going to look at tonight that basically have 80% the same language from existing ordinances, and then some things that are customized to the purpose of that commission.
Okay. Any comments or questions?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think I mentioned this last time in regard to this commission, and I'm not going to like fight over it really, but under the establishment and purchase, it says the purchase.
Purpose
of the commission is promoting and supporting improvement, beautification, growth, and creativity of the Yellow Springs community. And I don't really think that is the purpose. I think the purpose is narrowly defined of in regard to things on public property. That's my understanding. So, like I said, I'm not going to fight over it, but I think it's rather vague and might be better if it were tightened up so that it's clear it's only dealing with art culture on public property.
Was that in the original purpose, Brian?
It's been in there for about 3 months. This was the recommendation that the commission made when they looked at what we'd been doing for a year and a half. And so we've seen it before. I guess I don't know how in-depth we've discussed it.
Well, I think that one of the things that the commission has been doing is the VITA, the Village Inspiration and Design Award, and that really is about recognizing citizen
which is on
contribution to the arts on private property. I wish, and I'm sorry, Brian, I wish I would have read this a little bit closer. I think it would be good maybe to have something about public property, that is the primary role. Is that?
It does say that under powers and duties,
okay.
A, it says public spaces.
Yeah.
So it's in there. It's
just okay. Mm-hmm. So let's, I think that's.
Okay.
I'm okay with it.
Okay. Well, I have another comment if we're ready,
mm-hmm.
which is something that Kate brought up under HRC, and I totally did not see it. So it's under B, in regard to the role of the council liaison. It says the council liaison is charged with directing and supervising commission activities in line with village goals and objectives. Actually, Kate also was concerned about
is that under the HRC
it's in each.
It's standardized.
That's what I thought, but I'm having trouble finding it.
This is a standard
members
language that
procedures
comes
from part D.
And
okay.
Is that what we're saying the council liaison does, direct and supervise the commission?
So this was part of discussion. I mean, this wasn't in the version on April 2nd that when I looked back at the HRC when we looked at it, but it was something that council talked about for a couple meetings. And there was a feeling that we needed to clarify what the council liaison is supposed to do. So this wasn't like surprise language that just got, you know, stuck in there. We did talk about it.
Okay.
So this was
something that happened several months ago.
Yeah, we talked about it. We said we should be
I guess
clear.
I do have, I don't think the council liaison directs.
I agree. And I'm sorry, Brian, this happens all the time.
I just want to clarify this wasn't like a surprise.
Right. Thank you for clarifying that.
So
The other previous language in the different commissions didn't really say anything about the council role on the commission. So there is a role, but I'm not sure that these are the best words.
Could I suggest language? Could we try coordinating?
Or I was going to say ensuring commission activities are in line with village goals and objectives.
I like both of those words, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely say directing and supervising is probably way beyond what that.
It's too strong, yeah.
Ensuring?
Ensuring commission activities remain or are in line with village goals and objectives.
Coordinating, and yours was coordinating village activity.
Coordinating commission activities in line with village goals.
Actually, then we don't have to add are.
Yeah.
Coordinating?
Well, it could it be both? Ensuring.
And communicating, how about communicating? Council goals.
Yeah, that.
Okay, that's a different sentence then. You're wanting to commute, you're wanting to say that the village, the liaison's real job is really to communicate council's goals and sort of coordinate the commission's activities in line with those goals?
That's. And communicate back to council too. I mean, that's what the liaison part is.
But I like to ensure because to me, the council liaison should always make sure that the commissions are following the goals.
What about charged with coordinating commission activities in line with village goals and objectives and ensuring communication between council and commissions?
Yeah.
Or just, and communicating ensuring communication between both bodies.
Between,
yeah. Council, and maybe even include staff in that, but I guess if
staff
council.
Staff is on there too.
Okay.
They're already an ex officio member.
Okay.
Council and the commission.
Yeah.
Patty, can you just get
your
language?
Charged with coordinating commission activities in line with village goals and objectives and ensuring communication between council and commission.
Okay. Sue, can we hear from you?
I'm Sue Abendroth. Several years ago, there was a council retreat in which this particular issue was discussed at length. I think Karen may have been the only other person there at the time. It was a number of years ago. Mm-hmm. But the takeaway that I got from that meeting was that the solicitor, and it was your predecessor, was very firm in the understanding, or gave a very firm understanding, that the commissions that work under council have to be directed and supervised by council in order to make sure that they are doing what council wills, not what individual members of the commission will. So I don't know how I would like to have some clarification on that aspect of the responsibilities of the council liaison in terms of the functioning of the commissions, which are representatives of council and work under council's mandate. So could you clarify what that role is in this language? I know that's what you're working on now, but it seems somewhat optional that the commission could determine what they wanted to do, and as long as the council liaison felt that it wasn't in conflict with council's views, that would be okay. But in fact, I don't think they're charged with doing things individually as citizens. They're charged with helping council meet council's responsibilities. It seems sticky to me to just not leave that clarified. Thank you.
I guess I'd like to just. To me, where the part that says ensuring commission activities are in line with village goals, to me that phrase is saying making sure that the commission is doing what council thinks the commission should do. I support the other two words, coordinating and communicating, because I think one of the things that our commissions do is they have expertise that is not on council. So a commission may recognize something in the community or some opportunity or threat that council doesn't recognize because council doesn't have that expertise. And then through the liaison, we'll bring that to council. So that, in that way, that's an initiated activity through the commission. And then council has the option of saying yes or no, or we want you to tweak this. Or
can we read this?
When I first got on council, and I understand what Sue's saying, that was my understanding of the commissions, that they worked and did tasks that were directed by council. And I think, you know, some people may feel that the commissions are getting away from that. But, you know, it's, you know, like I said, it was my understanding that they did a council assignment task and they did.
Well, if the council liaison is directing and supervising, the council liaison would be the president of the commission, de facto president of the commission. We've kind of decided that we actually didn't want that to happen.
That's the way I feel.
Generally. And I think that there probably are times that council isn't always giving direction to commissions. Mm-hmm. So if commissions are going to be active and actively working, they probably are going to need to come up with some of their own directives, or there will be long periods of time where they don't, mm-hmm. where they may not be doing anything if they don't get a specific directive from council.
So honestly, I think this is semantics, but I feel that both wordings, like Mary Ann said, accomplish the same goal, so I'm okay with that change. Mm-hmm. But reading directing as, you know, you are the dictator or something, that's not what we meant when we put that in there. But I'm fine with the other language. Mm-hmm.
Can you reread the language for us, Patty, or Judy, maybe?
Oh, I do not have it.
Okay.
Patty has it.
One member shall be a council liaison appointed to serve at the pleasure of council, charged with coordinating commission activities in line with village goals and objectives, and ensuring communication between council and commissions. And surprisingly, I remembered that.
Yeah. Do we need a motion on that language?
Yes, I would do that.
Okay, I move to amend the ordinance with the wording that Patty just read.
Should we amend all?
Well, we'll just
we'll
deal
start
with
this.
Each one
at a time.
Okay. Yeah.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. So any other discussion related to the ordinance or the language, the charter language? Anything from citizens on, let's just talk about this one, which is arts and culture.
But since this is standard language.
We're reading each one. We'll talk about each one as we get to it. Okay.
So we might change one and not change them all?
We have to vote on their ordinances, so we have to go through two readings on each of them.
I guess I'm separately. Suggesting that since Kate had a concern about the use of the word village and that it would apply to all of the standardized language.
What was the concern?
I'm not sure it would apply to all of them necessarily, but
I did read your
we got
your
email so late.
Your
and
your
there's letter room. There's letter J mm-hmm. under section 0.03 if we want to talk about that now. Recommend to council actions that could be taken to accomplish the goals of the village.
Is it letter I?
No, it's J. Oh, I'm sorry. They change a little bit from...
It is I.
Some commissions have more.
Oh, okay.
But in this one, you're right, it's I, but in the HRC one, it's J. And I actually think that Mary Ann's suggestion is a good one.
What's the suggestion?
Because if it's a problem for the HRC ordinance, maybe it's a problem for others.
Well, I think we should talk about it, but I think we can talk about it on this one, so I'm fine doing that. And then we'll have to amend each of them
separately.
Right.
So, okay, so...
Yeah, could we have the...
I recommend that when you're talking about it, so the amendment that you proposed is to ordinance 288.02B, that you reference what the actual section is, so it gets into the minutes.
Oh, okay.
Okay, did you...
Good idea.
Judy, did you get that?
Yeah, right now, I have no idea what you guys are talking about, so...
Okay, I got it, Judy.
That motion that was just made and seconded and approved to modify section 288.02B.
Okay, so the next bit is something that will come up later that maybe we should talk about now, which is 288.03I. Recommend to council actions that could be taken to accomplish the goals of the village.
It's also in 288B, village goals and objectives.
Right, so...
So this is based on Kate's letter that she just emailed to us not long before this meeting.
Right, and which I haven't had time to read.
Right, so I'll just, do you mind if I just read your request, or do you want me, would you prefer to do it yourself? Okay. I'll just read that, this relevant section. She says we would request a removal of the word, directing as well as in line with village goals and objectives. Who is village referring to? It seems that village is being used to represent council. So I'll go ahead, and she argues instead the word village should reflect back to the mission statement. So the village is the village as a governmental entity, and every year council sets goals and objectives. Every year we do this. And that's what we call the village goals, the goals and objectives for Village of Yellow Springs for 2016. So to me, that's very clear as a council person that every year the council will set these goals and objectives, and then we communicate those to commissions, and the commission's work should be in line with those goals and objectives that have been set forth. And we do it all in public sessions, so if people don't feel that our goals and objectives are appropriate, or they're a problem, or they don't fit with what any resident here believes we should be doing, everybody can come, they can write us letters, they can engage with us in that process. So to me, there is such a thing as village goals and objectives set by council, and it's reasonable to have that language in here.
We do call them council goals.
Do we call them council?
We do call them council goals.
Oh, okay. Ignore what I said. I was misremembering. I was so sure of that, I didn't even think to question myself.
But we do have village values.
But that's not what it says.
You could just add goals of the village as iterated in council.
Or we could just say, in line with council goals and objectives.
Because council goals, values, and goals, or council principles and goals. Because I don't think we actually have objectives. Do we have objectives?
Yeah,
we do have. Council principles. Do we call them principles or values?
Values.
Values, and then we have
and
goals.
And those are village values, actually.
Village values, council goals, and objectives. Stir.
I know. I mean, is this really that important to change all these?
To me, it's clear.
I think
yeah,
it's
I think we should just leave it.
Because
I don't think it's worth.
Because we do this every year.
It's not worth changing.
This is the process.
It's not worth it. Yeah. What's the, is there more?
Those were the ones that fit the general, that would apply to all the ordinances.
Okay.
So,
okay.
So I think that's it for.
So we're leaving the village as is.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. That's okay. Okay, so are we ready to take a vote, our first vote on this one?
Yes.
Which one are we on?
We're still on arts and culture. We're still on 2015-21.
Yes? Okay. Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Okay, next one is 2015-21.
22.
22?
No, 21. You're right. 21. I got ahead of myself.
Yep. This is repealing old Chapter 280, Community Access Panel of Title 8, Boards and Commissions, Part 2, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 280, Community Access Panel.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So the first thing we know is that we're making the recommended change to 208.02.
280.
280.02B.
Mm-hmm. So if there could be a motion
there. Motion for that change?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Any other comments or changes on this particular one? Okay. Any comments, Paul?
Paul Abendroth. Before I was station manager, before I was chair of this commission, when I was just a member of the commission, it was called the Cable Advisory Panel. Mm-hmm. And it was a board of directors for an enterprise in that room or down the street with a buffer to the village, because the village was handling the money for that enterprise. I don't see anything at all in this proposed paper that addresses that role. There's almost nothing about the station in there, and I think there should be, because that was why this commission was formed, was to provide citizen control and advice over the running of a public access television channel. Now, times have changed, technology has changed, but I think that should still be a major part of that commission. Thank you.
Well, I guess I should just say there's no language that wasn't in the current ordinance that hadn't been put into this ordinance. So, that's a whole bigger issue in my mind of, you know, are we going to change the nature of even the current ordinance? Correct me if I'm wrong, Paul, right? I mean, nothing's been deleted from the current one.
I think there were earlier ones.
Okay. So I don't think that's a reason to not approve this ordinance, but it may be a reason to
revisit
in the future.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So are we ready to take the vote? Okay. Judy?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. 22.
Repealing old Section 284, Economic Sustainability Commission of Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 284, Economic Sustainability Commission.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, so first thing we'll do is change Chapter 284.02B to match the language that we agreed to previously.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any other comments or questions or changes?
Yes, Brian, is this the one that we said went from 7 to 9, or am I thinking?
All of them have a range of 5 to 7 with the potential of having two alternates.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Ready to take any comments from citizens? Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. 23.
repealing old Chapter 286, Energy Board, Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 286, Energy Board.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, first, well, can I get a motion to change the language of 286.02B to match the agreed-upon language?
Move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any other comments or questions? Citizens? Okay, let's take the vote.
Asplund.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes. First reading of ordinance 2015-24.
Repealing old Chapter 278, Library Commission of Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 278, Library Commission.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. First, we will, I'd like a motion for, to change Chapter 278.02 B to the previously agreed upon language.
So moved.
And that is 288.02B.
Yes. 278.
278. Oops, sorry.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. Any other comments or questions about this one? Citizens, any comments or questions?
Hold on.
Sorry.
What is?
I couldn't find anywhere in here where it talked about the number that was on that particular commission.
5-7. A 278A.
.02A.
I think they're all that. That's the first.
Yeah.
Oh, it's down in the
membership and procedure.
Okay. That's why.
Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Sims.
Yes.
Asplund.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes. Next is first reading of ordinance 2015-25.
Repealing old Chapter 276, Human Relations Commission of Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 276, Human Relations Commission.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. First, we'll entertain a motion to modify 276.02B to match the previously agreed upon language.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. And actually, I'd like to make another motion because Kate did point out a grammatical error that makes the meaning weird. So it's 276.03A.
Mm-hmm.
And it should be within the village, not with the village, which would kind of be opposite of what we're trying to do. So I'd like to make a motion to change that section to within.
You can do that, actually. You don't need to move that.
You can call that a... Okay.
Cool.
That's not substantive.
Thank you. Anything else? Any comments from citizens?
I wasn't able to look through every single one that you're doing tonight for the different commissions, but one thing I was curious about on all of the commissions is the liaison also a voting member on each commission?
Mm-hmm.
And it's always been like that?
It was. So this was one of the things that drove this process was in some of the ordinances it's clear and some it's not.
Right.
So that's one of the things we wanted to standardize. I think that was a change from my understanding that in the past, the liaison was just kind of in the room. But as we, you know, there was changes in ideology and a thought that the liaison should be a voting member. So we decided that we would standardize that way.
Okay. So that's like that for every commission then?
Right.
Yes.
Okay. And then the other thing I was curious about is in the proposed change, there's a lot of times where it says its purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm confused by what that would exactly mean for each. Would it refer to our mission statement, because we're very, at least in HRC, we're very cognizant of what our mission statement says. So when people ask for funding, we, you know, go through our mission statement word by word to make sure that somewhere it'll fit in there, and if it doesn't, it doesn't get funded. So I'm just curious about when it says its purpose, because I know you're doing a generic thing, but...
Right. Well, that means for HRC 276.01, establishment and purpose, where we've duplicated the purpose statement.
Okay.
So, yeah, so its purpose is found in that first section, so just like with the others. Yeah.
Okay, so its purpose is basically the mission statement.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I think the only other thing was that typo in the... wording.
Thanks for catching that.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Ready to call the vote? Judy?
Yes. Asklund?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Winter?
Yes.
Can I ask a quick question? It was only just sort of as we've been going through this that I've noticed these cross-references. Right?
I just carried them over. I don't know if they're...
Okay. Because it was back on the Library Commission, and it was just sort of caught my eye as we were finishing. The last like most of them make sense, but the last one under Library Commission is detention and arrest powers. And I can't really for the life of me think why that would be cross-referenced
right.
to the Library Commission. It just seems
608.17
kind of random.
I did not look at
that was actually kind of my question. Did we actually look at that to make sure that's like a logical thing?
We didn't. It'd probably be a good idea.
I mean, I don't think it like gives the librarians the power to arrest people for their library fines, or I would be in trouble. I just don't know why that's cross-referenced there.
Let me see if I can find it on here. If you want to move on, I can.
Yeah, let's. So we've taken that vote. Okay, next. Finally, the last one. First reading of Ordinance 2015-26.
Repealing Old Chapter 274, Environmental Commission of Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administrative Code of Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 274, Environmental Commission.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
The next thing I will do is ask for a motion to modify 274.02B to match the previously approved, agreed upon language.
I move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Any comments or questions about this one? Marianne, since it's your commission, do you have anything? Okay. Any citizens? Okay. Judy, would you please call
yes.
the roll on that one?
McQueen?
Yes.
Asklund?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Howe?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Okay. That was relatively painless. Now we're on to Resolution 2015-43.
This is a resolution accepting the amounts and rates as determined by the Budget Commission and authorizing them to the necessary tax levies and certifying them to the county auditor. And I'll let Melissa explain the particulars.
Can I get a motion, please?
So
move.
Second.
Okay. I will let Melissa take this on.
Basically, what this does is basically the document that we receive back from the Greene County Auditor after we submit our tax budget, which is done in July. None of the amounts had changed from the original presentation of the tax budget. So basically we had to give them our budget and demonstrate the need for all of the property tax dollars that we would receive from the county. They gave us an original estimate, and based on the budget that we submitted to them, they verified that we would receive those same amounts. So these figures that you see in Schedule A are the same figures that are incorporated into the budget that we will be looking at tonight. So usually this came late this year. Normally we have to have this done in October.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But we didn't get it until the end of October. So I called to verify that the schedule would be pushed back, and you know that we would still be safe to approve that this at this meeting tonight, and they said yes. So it is coming a little late, though. It's normally in October that we would do this. So It's just accepting the amounts that they are giving us back, which have remained unchanged since July.
And that is an 8.4 mil that brings in $759,000.
Correct.
Plus, there's a previous 0.3 mil that brings in $29,000 for the police pension, and another 2.3 that brings in $222,000 to the general fund.
Correct. So that divides out what the property taxes we would receive with the levy and without the, well, actually, the inside amounts are what we would receive, and the outside amounts are what the levy provides to us. So it outlines those two.
Okay. Any comments or questions from council?
Oh, I think I've commented on this almost every year, yes, that they still say Mr. They changed the, you know, the 19 to 20, but somehow never has occurred to them to not refer to every single person who might be serving on a council as Mr.
And I'm guessing that throughout Greene County, it's probably half and half. So
yeah, I mean, it's
they're ticking off a lot of people.
Well,
apparently not me. Enough. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, weren't you going to write a letter last year?
I think I was. Did I do it? No, I didn't. I never did.
Well, you'll have lots
maybe
of
when
time
I'm
next
not
year.
On council.
Yeah, really. Comments or questions from citizens?
And I do have to call roll on this, all you misters.
Oh. Okay.
Specified. So, Asplund.
Yes, sir.
McQueen.
Yep.
Winter.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Okay.
Just for the record, 608.17 has to do with purpose depriving the library, museum, or archival institution of property owned by it or in its custody.
Oh. So, well, okay.
Don't steal books.
Come on, Mom. All
right. So. Or claim them. It's part of the village property, mm-hmm, in this case, probably.
Okay. Next is, could be my favorite ordinance, or my favorite resolution of the year, 2015-45.
By its scanty title only, but it means so much more. Approving the annual distribution of flour and sugar.
Thank you. Do we need any discussion on this other than this is something that was enacted by Wheeling Gaunt when he donated the land for Gaunt Park to the village. He asked that widows, and we've added widowers and we've removed worthy, so all of you, worthy or not, are eligible. Receive, I think it was first just flour, and I think we added sugar because we decided you can't make good cookies without sugar. So, at some point, I'm not sure when, do we know when the electric department is going to be delivering?
We do not, because we can't really order it until we pass the resolution.
Oh, okay. So let's get that done. Any other comments?
Well, always if people know of people who are recently bereaved in the village of a spouse, please let someone on staff or a council person know so that we make sure everyone who's eligible is included.
And I just have to say, it's one of the reasons that we have such an amazing village. I mean, this is something that people always talk about and love, so.
And we do still need a motion.
Oh, we didn't get a motion on that
one?
So
moved.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. 2015-46.
This is approving easement purchase priorities for the Village of Yellow Springs with regard to collaboration with Tecumseh Land Trust.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. This is a proposal that was brought to us at the last meeting by Mary Ann McQueen that had been worked, a collaboration between Tecumseh Land Trust and the Environmental Commission, recommending that we prioritize our easements purchases. Mary Ann, why don't I turn it over to you?
Well, I have a concern that they aren't numbered. You know, I'm not sure that it's clear with four bullets that the first one is
the first priority
and so on.
That's not a substantive change, is it, Chris? Can we just?
No, I would consider that.
Okay.
Just to add the numbers.
Was the intention to have the bullet points there in order?
They are prioritized.
By virtue of the order that.
Exactly.
Just clarifies the designation in my view.
Yeah, it says prioritized as follows, which I would think indicates that. I will say that Krista McGough approved the resolution and added the little tiny change that you've got to the version in front of you.
What's the tiny change?
What's the tiny change?
Is
it in the electronic copy that I have?
No, I don't know.
It's on the desk.
It originally said appropriate purchase of properties. It was changed to recommend appropriate easement or fee purchase of properties.
Yeah, that's what's in my packet.
Yeah. I don't think, given the language above, I think it would be redundant to do the numbers, so let's just keep the bullet so we don't make any changes.
Yeah, because it does say shall be prioritized as follows.
So can, we have a motion. Any comments from citizens? Any other comments from council? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, resolution 2015-47.
Authorizing the village manager to enter into agreement with HD Supply for electric meter installation and related tasks.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I will turn this over to Patty.
This was a proposal brought before council at the last meeting. We are, as council knows, going to install remote read electric meters. We got two prices from two different companies to do that installation for a couple of reasons. Number one is because Johnny's electric crew is, as we all know, running a person short right now and will be for the foreseeable future, and they are in the middle of trying to tidy up a few other projects. So to make this a little bit more expedient, we looked at having an outside company do the installation. There were two companies that submitted bids. One was Utility Sales and Service for $38,000, I believe $38,500, and the other was HD Supply for $31,000. For the $31,000, HD Supply will not only install each meter, they will also tag each meter, scan it into the system. They will note meters that are not properly installed currently so that our crews can go back and make sure they're brought up to code. They will GIS these meters, which is something that we're trying to move towards anyway, and they will do this all within 2 weeks to a month to get these up and running.
Is there an estimate of when they're proposed to start?
They will start as soon as council approves this and we get the contract signed.
Okay.
And this is all tied to also to the fact that right now they can't, there's not time to look at water meters every month.
That's correct.
And so this will allow, this won't mean a cut in staff, but it will allow the staff to check water meters, which is helpful for consumers, because ratepayers, because if you have, if there's a leak that's developed, it'll be easier to catch it if we're reading those meters every month.
Correct. That is correct.
And how will citizens be notified?
They will, if they go to your house, they will knock on your door to let you know that they're there. If you're not there, they will leave you a door hanger that says we were here and installed your new remote read electric meter. You know, you might have to reset your clock or something like that, but they will knock on your door to see if you are there and let you know what they're doing.
Okay.
And when is the 2 week to a month period likely to be, before the end of the year or starting next year?
Yes, that's what we're hoping to get it all done before, well before Christmas.
Hmm. And do people, I'm trying to see what these things look like. Do people have a choice about where they're installed? I mean,
no, that will be up to, they'll be installed in the same location unless that location is difficult currently
to access.
Yes, we do have some that are underneath decks or up on the second floor and they have to like climb up to read it, and so those will be moved to a more suitable location, but for the most part they will go generally back where the connection is now.
Okay. All those in, oh, Sue, I'm sorry.
Sue Avendroth. I have a question about meters be changed. These are going to be changed throughout the village.
Yes.
Every meter will be changed?
Mm-hmm.
Because we own a house in the older section of town where the meter was installed in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
And the tenant there is a working person, mm-hmm. so when they knock on the door, there's not likely to be an answer.
Mm-hmm.
How do we and others in this situation fix this? So
in that case, probably Johnny would be the person who would contact you and ask you to call to set up an appropriate time, because those will have to be moved outside to make this work.
Yes, sir.
Michael Bell. Are we able to refuse these meters because they emit strong RF frequencies and they're constant frequencies? It's similar to having a really strong cell phone, like right on your deck, irradiating your child.
That wasn't something that council addressed, and I mean, we can look into the potential hazards of that, but this was the direction that council chose to go. I mean, I can ask Johnny to call you with some information if you would like.
Okay.
Or you can email him and talk to him. Johnny Burns is the electric superintendent.
And so if it goes through, there'd be no opportunity to refuse a meter like this?
It would be my recommendation that they be standardized, but I mean, that would be up to council.
Can you say more?
Well, I used to live in Phoenix, Arizona, and they installed them at my house, and I researched it, and it's not like your cell phone where, you know, you place a call and it tries to find a signal, it boosts up your, you know, or basically the radiation coming out of your cell phone. It's a constant, very strong radiation that's emitted, you know, using the electricity from your house. And it's a constant thing that constantly shoots out in the air, you know, every direction. The signal that is received by a receiver somewhere, similar to, you know, like a Wi-Fi cell phone.
Mm-hmm. And are you saying that there's evidence that that is dangerous?
I wouldn't want mine's right on my deck, and I don't want my children, his sandbox is right there. I don't want him playing next to a really strong cell phone mm-hmm. for hours on end.
When Melissa and Johnny were researching these, they didn't run into anything like that, but we can certainly look into it.
Okay.
Because you didn't correct.
Are you finding anything?
Well, the I'm reading the American Cancer Society. They say that smart meters typically send and receive short messages about 1% of the time. They say it's not constant, but I have to look at our particular thing. They said usually.
I can redo some research. I did this was probably about 7 years back now.
Mm-hmm.
But it just caught my attention being on the agenda.
I mean, because I'll be honest with you, I've not heard that about remote readers. Remote meters, it doesn't mean it isn't true, but it's not something that I've heard. Maybe the technology has changed. I don't know.
If I was to find some information, would I be able to forward it to someone?
Sure, absolutely. You can forward it to me at the village offices, and my email address is on the website.
Okay, excellent.
Or us as your representatives, whatever you want to do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to take a vote on this?
I do.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Finally, Resolution 2015-48, a very important one.
Yes, this is determining the necessity of levying a renewal of an existing 8.4 mil property tax levy in excess of the 10 mil limitation for the purpose of paying for current operating expenses of the village to run for 5 years pursuant to section 5705.19 as amended, and requesting the county auditor to certify matters in connection therewith.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So this is the first in a series of legislation that we will be passing regarding the levy. This is, again, the property tax levy. This will be the third time it will be on the ballot. The election actually will be in March. Because it's a presidential primary, it is in March. So our timetable of needing to get to these pushed up a bit. So this is the first one. any other questions? There may be some things that Melissa wants to add.
Yeah, we are going for a renewal, and it is for operating. So the renewal will be a zero increase for taxpayers. There are a number of ways in which you can kind of tweak a levy, and with some of the changes at the state level, any changes that we would make to our levy would make the rollback in the homestead that the state is currently paying go away, and that would be passed on to the homeowners, which would result in an increase even if we didn't change the millage at all. So we decided that the best strategy is just to do a renewal so that it would be the same amount of money coming in as what we've been accustomed to, and it wouldn't cost the property owners any additional money on their annual property taxes. So
any comments or questions, council? Citizens, comments or questions? Bringing it back to council. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Now is the time in the meeting where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. We ask that you come up to the podium, state your name, and keep your remarks to 3 minutes. Paul?
Paul Abendroth. First, tomorrow is election day. We vote at Antioch Midwest this time. There's a new system. There'll be one line coming in. Go in the right-hand aisle behind the auditorium and go from there.
The right. Okay. So as you're coming in the lobby?
Go to the right.
Go to the right. Okay.
All right. Second, I want to thank council for going ahead with the bottleneck reduction or elimination project. Finally, it's been decades and decades, and I think we'll all see better water pressure, and people might check with their insurance companies. They may get a reduction in their insurance rates with more reliable water. Third, a couple meetings ago, I asked that you consider a stormwater policy. Like, willing to work with you on that. We had a light rain. The drain across from my house is plugged up again. Water ran across the street and down the driveway, eroding some of the driveway. This happens several times a year. This is new. This did not happen when I moved in about 30 or 40 years ago. This is a change, climate change, or development of the neighborhood, or something. There's nothing that I can do about it. And I look to the village to do something about this and other stormwater problems in town. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Any other comments or questions or concerns from citizens? Kate?
Kate Hamilton. I had two or three people contact me about a new thing with utilities, that they aren't, they're no longer getting a note posted on their door or a shutoff, and it's on the bill. So it says the day that it would be shut off, they don't pay their bill. And I guess now it's automatically shut off versus having a note. No?
No.
So do you think that's like a
I don't
strange
think the policies
case?
Really, or procedures
no,
have not changed
we
at all.
We hand them a stack of notices to put on the doors.
So they still put them on the door?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. She said that they didn't anymore, and that they were told that it was because there's too many people not paying their bills.
No.
Okay,
no.
So that policy hasn't changed. They still
no,
get
we
the
haven't
notice
changed that procedure at all.
And that's an ordinance, too, so
yeah.
We
right,
follow
I
the
didn't
ordinance.
Think it could just change.
Right.
But, and then it's probably been asked before, but what is the legality or the policy for shutting off electricity to people who are disabled and rely upon it? Like, do you have a list of people?
Oh, you mean for medical?
For medical reasons, yeah, for, you know, events and stuff like that.
We have a list, and I right off the top of my head, I can't remember if it's 6 months or if it's a year, but we have to have a doctor's note within those time frames because they will expire. So
okay.
If the residents don't follow up with us, then they'll be removed from the list. So the police department actually maintains it.
Okay. Is it every 6 months they need to?
I can't remember if it's 6 months or if it's a year. I would need to double check that, but I know it's one or the other.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Kate. Anything else? I want to thank Paul for Paul's comments about the election day tomorrow. That's actually probably an announcement we should have made here when the meeting started. And to reiterate, Antioch University Midwest is where everybody in the village will be voting. I was really surprised because I got my card in the mail. I was surprised to see some discussion on Facebook even today, people not totally understanding that. So anybody you know that's going to vote tomorrow, and I'm sure that hopefully Antioch College will have signs up, because I have a feeling that there will be a few people going to the South Gym to vote. We have no special reports, old business. First item on the agenda is the 2016 budget. We've had two special sessions to go over the general fund, enterprise funds, and special funds, and capital improvements. Tonight, we will be reviewing the final budget with all of the revisions that have been made through those meetings with council input. And I will turn it over to Assistant Village Manager and Finance Director Melissa Van Zandt.
Okay, I first want to draw everyone's attention to the capital budget, because all of the projects that were outlined on and presented in the capital budget at the last meeting were incorporated into the budgets, the final budgets that we see. I think it was inserted towards the end of the online packet. It's just a one-page document. And it is. It's the very last page in the online packet, the Yellow Springs capital budget. So there are 5 years listed on this, and there are some projects that are not happening this year but are happening in future years. But there were $470,100 worth of capital projects that were incorporated into the budget. In total, the most notable were the streetscape projects. So we did update the capital budget and the electric and the streets budgets to include actually continuing and finishing streetscape. So of that, there was $218,000 total for out of the streets budget. And then there was an additional $150,000 that was coming out of the electric fund in order to cover. And those were figures given by Jason Hamby and Johnny Burns as well. So that was the only major change that was made to the capital budget that was then folded into the respective budgets to finish out streetscape. And that did include in front of the Speedway, correct, Patty?
Mm-hmm. Yes, those final figures did.
So if everyone is supportive of that, if there's any discussion about any of the items in the capital budget actually being included, then we could talk about that. But at the end of the last meeting, it seemed as if council was favorable towards all of the projects that were on the list, including finishing out the streetscape.
Mm-hmm. I do have a concern. At our last meeting, before the streetscape was included, we were under the impression that the 2016 budget, the general fund budget, was going to be in the black.
With operating, that was just operations. Mm-hmm. Any projects above and beyond that would have had an effect on that.
Okay, I guess I didn't understand that. So my understanding was, and in fact, I think I said at the candidates meeting that 2016, we were going to be in the black, and from then on we were. But it was the street, isn't it the streetscape that flipped us into the red?
Any capital project would have put us into the
red.
Well,
how much is the streetscape?
Well, actually, the general fund has a transfer that goes out that supports the streets fund. And so any changes that we made to the streets budget would directly affect the general fund budget. So the streetscape portion that was coming out of the street fund was $218,000 total.
Well, the net result, and maybe I'm not quite getting it, but the net result is that the budget for 2016 is now $250,000 in the red, about, right?
Correct. We did include what was part of that general fund, deficit at this point. Well, I mean, it's not really a deficit because we're spending into the reserves that we already have, and we have adequate enough reserves to be able to support these projects. If you look at the very last page, I've got a little breakdown of how much we should have in reserves, and our minimum reserves that we should have in that fund are just under $1.2 million. And at the end of 2016, we should have $1,575,000 projected. So we would still have more than enough in our reserves in order to cover those projects.
So would it be fair to say that the reason why we're going to be in the red is because funds are being taken out of capital funds, or that maybe they weren't designated as capital funds, but essentially that's what they are?
Basically, we're using some of our reserves to support capital projects.
And they were
since
not,
we don't have those capital funds built up yet.
Okay. Well, there wasn't a category for them. Right? I mean, we weren't putting money away for capital
we
projects.
We are starting this year.
No, I mean, we were not.
In the past, no, we were not. So what we had been doing previously and what we're doing again this year, at least in this case, is we were using some of our reserves to support capital projects. But starting in 2016, we are transferring money out of all of the various funds into those capital improvement funds in order to be able to use those funds that we will have built up over the next couple of years to support projects like this.
But in some respects, it's kind of a moot point whether it's coming out of general fund reserves or it's coming out of capital project reserves.
I guess
it's
my
all the
concern
same
is, first of all, because I did think that we were going to be in black, which we won't be. I get that we're taking, but that if we continue to do this year after year, well, that's not a good path, and I thought we were getting out of that path.
Well, and we are, which is why Melissa and I recommended to council, and you agreed, to start putting that money into
yes.
the capital
right.
funds
right.
for each
yeah.
of those enterprise funds, as well as for the general fund. It's just something that hasn't been done yet, and it begins in the 2016 budget. Those lines now become active again, because that's what council said that they wanted to move toward.
And
it's just unfortunately in the past it hasn't been there, so if you want to do a capital project at this point, it has to come from the general fund reserve.
So I guess I would just like to know if other council members are comfortable with that.
Yes.
I'm comfortable with it because we spent a long time building up that large reserve.
Mm-hmm.
I'm more concerned if we're using reserves to do our operating, that is a bigger concern for me than if we're strategically investing reserves in things that help the community.
Strategically investing,
so
oh,
I
that
do.
Sounds great.
Well, and this having one side with good lights that are close to the ground that people can actually see, and another side with street lights that are very far up, that are, I believe, less efficient than the ones on the other side.
Terrible.
They're using a lot more energy and electricity, and there's a lot of sidewalk bulging on that side of the sidewalk where there's less light. So to me, it's a pretty important project to just finally bring to completion.
Well, and the other aspect of this is we have some cost savings if we do it all.
Correct.
You know, finish it now. If we spread it out, I mean, the bottom line might look better, but we will pay out more. So.
Right. Yeah, there is nothing frivolous. I don't believe any of these capital projects are frivolous. They're all important and I think well thought out and planned by staff. So I understand what you're saying, and you get concerned, but I think Lori's point that we had been in the past, even up until last year, we were looking at potentially going into the red just in the general fund operating.
Mm-hmm.
That we're out of that situation now. Not to say that we don't have to be mindful, but we're out of that kind of fearful situation because we have more revenues coming in than expected, and because staff's doing a great job of spending taxpayer money, or not spending it, maybe.
Spending it carefully.
Spending it carefully.
It should also be noted that as part of the transfers, which are on page, the very last page, page 5 of the general fund budget, there is $175,000 that is earmarked to transfer out to various, well, three capital capital funds for the capital equipment fund, the facilities improvement fund, and the parks and rec improvement fund. Each of those are $50,000 transfers respectively. And then there's also the $25,000 transfer out to green space. Uh-huh. So, you know, $175 right. is quite a chunk that we're committing of the general fund yeah. out to those other funds. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's important not to maintain exorbitant reserves and to invest in some of those capital funds that we'd been talking about. So,
Well, I appreciate this conversation from staff and council. And, you know, when I walk downtown, I really don't notice the street lights. But I do appreciate that the lights are going to be better and more efficient and the sidewalk will be better. So I'm glad to have that pointed out.
And great news. If you look at that last page, $69,094, final year of the Bryan Center bond repayment.
Yes. That started in 1990, is that right? Something like that?
Yeah,
our institutional memory doesn't quite go back that far.
No, 26 years or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's early 90s.
Is there anything else, Melissa? I mean, do you want to go through? Do we want to go through each budget?
I'll hit the highlights of each of the budgets. So we've got general fund. We'll take a look at that first, even though we've went over it quite a bit. The only changes that I made was Channel 5 budget. I increased the contractual services to be in line with the approved station manager contract. I didn't have my hands on that. So I did update those figures to accurately incorporate those terms that were in that contract for the whole year. The police department, I incorporated $40,000 for a cruiser. And then basically the only other changes were I increased the transfer out to the streets to accommodate the capital projects, added the $25,000 transfer out to the green space fund. So if we look back to what was originally presented, which was just operations, we were going to be in the black by approximately $58,000. So after these changes that were made with the capital and such, we will dip into reserves by $220,000, but we will still have a cushion of approximately $400,000 more than what the minimum reserves need to be, and that's projecting out to the end of 2016. So that's the general fund. Does anybody have any questions with any of those changes? Okay, the next one that we'll look at will be the special revenue funds, and these were just capital. So the changes that were made were directly tied to the capital. So I had to increase the transfer into streets by $204,000, which ties back to that amount on that transfer line in the general fund. And then I added the $218,000 for the continuation and finish of streetscape. And then parks, what I did was I had to increase that transfer by $15,000 because there was some debt service for a new mower that we purchased this year, and that line wasn't captured in the calculation. So I had to tweak the transfer coming in to make sure that we kept our reserves in line with what we should with the minimums. So those were the only changes that I made to the special revenue funds. So and all of those funds at the end of the year will have adequate reserves and nothing exorbitant. Does anybody have any questions about special revenue funds? Since we went over that last time, I mean, it should still be fairly fresh. The next budget that we had were the capital project and debt service funds, and I made no changes to those from the last time that we presented. You'll notice that we've got those transfers coming in as revenues that were coming out of the general fund, and some of the enterprise funds as well, transferring money out. Actually, I do take that back. There was one capital project that was included in the Parks and Rec Improvement Fund. Actually, there were a few. Renovator, and then the gutter valves at the pool, and then the gym ceiling. So there were a few capital projects coming out of that Parks and Rec Improvement Fund, but they were fairly minimal. Okay. And then we'll go over to the enterprise funds. As I said, the electric fund, it had the $150,000 added in to continue and finish streetscape. There were also a few other projects that were incorporated. There were pole replacements for $10,000, and there was also LED lighting for the Bryan Center parking and the electric stations at $25,000, for a total of $185,000 worth of capital projects. If you look at that very first page, which is the Reader's Digest version of the enterprise funds, the electric fund shows a large negative balance of $944,000. Keep in mind, we've got $500,000 moving out to the electric improvement fund, so that's the primary driver of that. Granted, our power costs did go up. We did incorporate an 18% increase, which was actually the middle of the road figure from what John Courtney had given us. I'd presented or proposed a 15% increase. He was requesting a 20, and Patty and I decided to do 18. So after this year, we shouldn't be dipping into reserves as we are this year, but we were committed to moving quite a bit of money out to that capital improvement fund. And then doing the streetscape project had a big impact as well.
Where is the page with the reserves for each fund?
It's on to the side.
Oh, yeah, it's on the side of that front.
Yeah. It is? Which page are you on here?
Sorry. Found it. I thought it was on the first page. I was on the second page.
Mm-hmm. I have all of the recommended reserves. The water fund will be below the recommended reserve, but then again, though, we need to kind of get ahead of the game, and we've got a lot of the loan payments for the projects this year coming out, so it's going to take us a little bit to catch up, but we're on the right track to do so, so I'm not concerned with that.
Are we doing a rate study for the electrical fund?
We did one.
We did the rate study. We haven't implemented it yet. Council hasn't voted on it.
Well, that's what you were just talking about, the 18%.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was sort of reading and
yeah, and I think that one of the things that we were kind of waiting on was for the Energy Board to recommend a rate structure, which I have that recommendation in my report tonight, okay. And we'll talk about that. Okay. And then Council will, after they agree upon the rate structure, John Courtney can look at that rate structure, and then Council can implement the 18%.
Okay. All right. Did I miss a presentation at the last meeting about this this rate study? Are we going to have an equivalent one to the one Wayne Cannon did?
John came quite a ways back and did the Energy 101 presentation along with his rate study.
Oh, I don't know. I'm sorry. My brain is fried, apparently. I remember him coming, and I remember him doing Energy 101, but I was so fascinated by that the rate study has gone out of my head, but I believe you. Thank you.
Do we need for him to come back? Or
no, I don't think so. No. Okay. I can. That means I can go back and look at notes if I need to. And, you know, might happen when I'm not even on council anymore. So.
And the water fund, in the last presentation, I believe it was in the black, but one of the things that needed to be folded in, which was an oversight, was the remaining costs of the consultant for the water plant. We had earmarked half of the costs in 2015, and then I'd forgotten that there were going to be more coming in 2016. So I talked to Patty. We figured out what was reasonably expected to come out this year, and then what would be coming out in 16. So we did fold that in. So that did affect the budget.
And then that entire amount will be also folded into the loan for the water plant when I apply in late December, early January.
And then will you pay the fund back?
Melissa will pay the fund back.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions, council, about the budget?
Well, the one thing that we had raised a couple meetings ago and we haven't revisited is thinking about other commissions. And, you know, particularly, you know, we've got Patty covering costs out of her budget. And we had, you know, indicated maybe we would carve out something in council's budget to accommodate those things.
Yeah, I mean, I think definitely we decided, I don't know if it's reflected in this budget. I doubt that those costs shouldn't be coming out of Patty's budget, that they should be coming out of council's budget.
I think a good approach would be for council to have further discussion on what they might want to do and how much money they might want to allocate to those various commissions. And then that could just be done very easily with a supplemental appropriation in the first half of 2016.
Okay. That's a good suggestion.
Well, I think that's a good suggestion, and I do think at some point it does maybe could go back to the commissions themselves to say, what activities do you foresee you might be doing that you would like funding for?
Mm-hmm. And maybe part of
we've
the
asked
plan.
Them for a budget.
Annual mm-hmm. plan.
Right.
Yeah.
So that could maybe come as part of their annual reports.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I would like to do that across the board then.
And mm-hmm. I assume that you don't have money specifically in your budget. I mean, you're just taking money.
Normally, it comes from something like professional services or something like that.
Right.
For instance, if John Courtney comes to meet with the Energy Board about the rate structure, that would come from professional services or something like
okay.
that.
Okay, so it's not something we need to change with the budget right
no,
now.
No,
okay.
That can be done later.
Okay. Great, good job, Melissa. This is very good. This has been
the best
most
budget.
Painless budget I've ever participated in. Thank
I was,
you.
One of my questions was going to be, in terms of orientation of new council member or members,
mm-hmm.
will having Melissa or someone go over this budget with them be part of that orientation?
Yes, I'm more than willing to provide whatever level of orientation that's requested. So
I think that would be a really good idea. I don't know how much planning has gone into orientation plans for the new council. Because there will be at least one new member, but I think especially since I don't think the two potential new members have come to these meetings, really getting oriented to this budget would make a lot of sense.
Mm-hmm. But are all the candidates getting packets? The two candidates who aren't currently members?
No, I mean it's so readily available.
Okay.
I saw no reason to separately send
okay.
packets.
Mm-hmm. Okay, are we all done talking about the budget, ready to move on? So at the next meeting, we will have our first reading of the budget ordinance, and then we'll finish it up the first meeting in December. We added next steps regarding the ACE task force. After our meeting or during our meeting Thursday night, it was decided that council did want to make a decision on this in 2015. It's something we had talked about providing to the community and to the police department for some certainty for 2016. We didn't really want to talk about it much tonight in detail because of the fact that we asked for citizen input and we really haven't given citizens enough time to provide a lot of input. We did receive two emails just today, so we haven't had time to consider those. So I've been thinking that it will be on our November 16th agenda. And I guess the question would be, do we need more time than that? Do we need more information? Is there anything we need from our staff to present? And do we want to talk about a special meeting?
Yeah, I mean, it seems like Karen, certainly you've said that you wanted some more information. And I think I said we're probably never going to have enough information. But I would think that it would be good for council and I guess citizens to have some input on what kind of, what things are important, what kind of information we want, and maybe be ready to bring that back either to the next council meeting, or, I mean, if Brian and I are going to take charge of some next meeting of having people send us their concerns, or the things that they want to know more about. Or a particular person, like, for example, if we wanted to have Franklin Halley come and talk about services.
I mean, I guess the first question would be, because what I was hearing from the rest of council is that the rest of council felt like they were ready to make a decision. And I seemed to be the only one looking for information. And I guess I have to say, upon reflection and talking to people, I could be ready to make a decision without more information. I mean, I assume we'll discuss.
The chief posted just today, late in the day, I believe. I saw it while I was eating my dinner. A statement on Facebook, basically giving more information than he was able to give at the last meeting. I certainly would like that. Were you planning on putting that in?
It is already when it was at like 4 o'clock. It is already Patty and Judy and
okay.
Will be.
It'll be in our packet. Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that was in the packet. And I guess as I was thinking about it, I was trying to think about, well, I think you both used something, a phrase like losing a seat at the table is kind of what we lose by not having a member of our force there. I'd like a better sense for what does that actually mean on the ground when, like, what do you, I can kind of guess, like, okay, so you've got a person who's actively investigating these crimes. If you could just sort of walk me through more generally, not tonight, but be prepared for next time. That's, I guess, what I would kind of like you, I think would be helpful for me, would be for you to kind of walk me through. Because as I see it, the crimes are still going to, if there's a crime going on in Yellow Springs that the ACE Task Force has awareness of and believes it's in their purview, they will still investigate. If it's potentially part of a series of crimes, they will still investigate it, just as Cedarville can have crimes in it. Cedarville is not one of the participating communities,
no.
Right? So Cedarville could have, and has had, I looked it up to see if that had happened, and there have been people dealing drugs in Cedarville who have been convicted by the ACE Task Force. So it's not that the ACE Task Force will cease to operate in Yellow Springs, but what's sort of the difference of having a person from our force?
I believe I understand.
And that's kind of where I am too, and because I see if we. My view would be, I would, as Lori said, things will still be happening, and I can't see us not maintaining a relationship with investigative authorities. And so I would like to understand how that would happen. I'm really just repeating what Lori said, but maybe looking at it slightly differently.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to know that ahead of time, and then he can reiterate it? Do you want to know ahead of time so you have time to consider
it? I always find if people give it to me in writing first,
yeah.
That is always better than trying to process information. And so having it in writing and being able to ask questions based on something that's gotten to me in writing in advance is always preferable.
So have we said we're going to have a special meeting to make this decision, or are we going to be making it the next meeting, or have we decided?
I think she was just saying we're going to try to make the decision.
I guess that's what I'm asking. I am ready. I think we could do that. We clearly got through this legislation pretty quickly. I mean, I think we got through the hard part of this legislation. I don't think there's a lot of legislation. I don't think it's going to take
right.
a lot of time. So I think we will have time
okay.
at the next meeting to have a discussion of it.
Uh-huh.
So I don't feel like we would be just making a short decision. I think we could hear from Chief. I don't know if there's anything additional we would need to hear from you two, but I think we could, have the discussion if citizens know they can be here and have time for input. And I guess if we can always, you know, maybe have the goal of making a decision on the 16th, we can always extend it. We've got, we can either have a special meeting or we could do it on the 2nd or the 20, or the 7th or the 21st or...
Because we've made the 21st into a regular session. It's not a work session anymore.
Well, and I think that I was actually hoping that we might be able to not have that meeting, but Patty or Judy pointed out to me that we have a piece of legislation that we have to pass that we have to have,
we
that,
have, to have that night.
So maybe it'll be a short meeting, but...
Okay. Sounds good.
So everybody's, so just for citizens and to understand, we will be, our plan is to make a decision on whether we will stay or leave the ACE task force at the November 16th meeting. That discussion will probably come, I'm thinking, around maybe around 7:30 to 8 o'clock in the evening.
Because we'll be starting at 6:30.
That's true. So is probably 7:30, 7:15, 7:30. It'll probably take us that long to get through all the legislation.
Well,
do you think?
I don't know. How long
maybe
did it
not.
How long did it take us to get through the legislation tonight?
Was
anybody paying attention?
It took about an hour, but remember that a lot of those were first readings of ordinances, and you didn't have
I would be surprised if it took us.
Okay, so let's say if people aren't able to get here at 6:30, that they should probably be here by 7 if they want to have a discussion.
It isn't marked. It's not marked as 6:30, I guess.
But we, I think we
did
made
we decide
decision that
the
they
rest,
were all
yeah,
going
the rest
to
of
be
the 6:30.
Yeah.
Okay. That's what I thought, too.
Okay. Any other discussion?
Not go about ahead. That, but the citizen, and I don't know your name.
Michael.
Michael
Bell.
Mm-hmm. Michael, raised this issue about smart meters, and Lori mm-hmm. looked it up, and then I was just looking on this one other site, which says the World Health Organization.
What is the site? Can you tell me?
ElectricSense.com. That the World Health Organization has listed smart meter radiation as a possible carcinogen.
Okay.
This means that your smart meter that's on all day and night all throughout the year can increase your risk of cancer and other diseases. And this site goes on to say they don't understand why utility companies are installing wireless smart meters when they can do the same job by more safely connecting to the regular phone line. Of course, a lot of people don't have regular phone lines.
Right. Okay. So I'm reading from. I mean, I don't. This is probably not the best way to do this kind of research.
I'm raising this because I don't think any of us even thought about this concern before, and we just, if we're going to sign a contract.
Well, napkin math too on that 1%. So that would be, even if it was, and I don't think it only the frequency is 1% of the time. That would be 14.4 minutes a day, 7 hours per month, and 84 hours a year.
Well, I do
that's
have
1%.
The scientists who I'm reading, who work at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, University of California, Davis, and a laureate professor of mathematics from Australia, they suggest that they run typically 1.4 seconds per day at very low wattage. If you stand less than 1 meter from a smart meter, when it broadcasts its data for that 1.4 second, the resulting microwave exposures is 555 times less than standing in front of an active microwave oven, 1,100 times less than holding an active cell phone to one's ears. But that's conservative, they say. Hmm. So I just have a sense that this is a... I did quite a bit of research on this when the issue came up around the cell phone tower. And so I have my doubts that these I just have my sense, and that this is a similar kind of situation. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not that we shouldn't look into it further, but I just don't think we're going to find it.
We've got a real problem though, because we just passed a resolution. Mm-hmm. Patty's ready to sign a contract tomorrow. to buy these things.
Oh, no, we've already bought them. That's just to install.
Right, yeah, that's just to install.
Oh, we own them, right.
We own them.
We own them, great.
And I will say, I mean, I understand your concern, because trust me, no one in this room is probably more careful about cancer than me, but...
She's a four-time cancer survivor.
I've just never heard of that in relation to smart meters, and I'm happy to look into it and give you a call back, which is why I asked you to get your contact information. It's just not something I've ever heard, and it's something I'm very careful about myself, so...
Well, and let's specifically get data about the smart meters that we have purchased, right? Because, you know, we're talking about seven-year-old data, and we're talking about lots of different kinds, and, yeah, cell phones from, you know, the 90s were terrible, you know, so we should know that.
Okay, next item on the agenda is, it's a new item, nominations for the Economic Sustainability Commission. Brian and I interviewed, I think, two or three, and Brian interviewed one other that I wasn't able to be there. So I will turn it over to you. Did you want to review, are you just going to make the nominations? Did you want to review?
I think I'll just quickly mention the four nominees that we have. So we talked with Henry Myers, with Taki Manakalos. Hope I didn't mess up his name too badly. That's one interesting one. As well as Matthew Kirk and also Saul Greenberg. And I know for myself, I appreciated that they all had economic development backgrounds, very diverse approaches and things that they're coming in with. And I guess the other piece of this is that, you know, if we start with four and we have a council liaison, then this commission can start meeting and being active. Karen, I don't know if you want to add anything else?
No, I just want to be clear that I want to be an alternate. I mean, I want to be involved in this commission.
Okay.
So,
I guess, you know, I've sort of put it out there that I would like to be the council liaison. That was a main reason for stepping off of the HRC.
Being liaison is fine, but I will be intending to attend all of the meetings.
Yeah. Well, I think it'd be great for you to be the alternate. So, yes.
And also, while we don't have his resume yet, Mr. Bell, who just moved here from Phoenix, he asked me Halloween night who to contact and so forth.
Great.
So,
and his resume. Good. And the process is we've standardized a resume, a letter of interest to our clerk, Judy Kittner, and then we do the council interviews and then bring nominations. So, and also to clarify, we have room for two more full members, and we can take on two alternates as well. So certainly we're still interested in participation.
Be nice to have a woman.
Yes.
I know. I'm there. I'll be there, even though I'm not a full member.
We might need to do some recruiting when we discover that we're getting a very, that's like all white men.
Yes.
Is it all white men?
Yes.
That we might want to actively seek out some diversity, gender.
Yes.
Ethnic.
I agree.
We have some ethnic diversity.
So I'd like to make a nomination move to nominate or accept all four of these nominees to the Economic Sustainability Commission.
Okay. I'll second that. And I think it's a diverse group, people from different backgrounds
right.
and ideas.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
Yeah, there is already some diversity there for sure.
Right. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. Next is manager and assistant village manager reports.
Okay, everybody sees that GM Pipeline is working like crazy down Xenia Avenue. They have charged and tested the first part of the line, and they are going to connect those services and lay those sidewalks, hopefully before the weather gets too cold. Then they'll finish laying to Cahoe, and at the end they will seed and straw, which may not happen to the spring depending on the weather. Also, the Public Works crew did install the new stormwater line on Davis, and that will be seeded and installed. It should be seeded and installed this week. Currently, our police department does not have jurisdiction to enforce village ordinances or any kind of law on village properties that are outside our municipal limits. This would include the water plant, Sutton Farm, Ellis Park. There is a simple, is it a resolution, Chris, or an ordinance? It's an ordinance that council could pass that would give our police department jurisdiction on our property, even outside the municipal limits of the village. And Chief and I have talked, and that would make it nice for our officers to be able to, you know, enforce on our property. It would not give them jurisdiction if they were outside the village and not on our property, but it is important that we be able to protect our own properties in that way. So if council is in agreement, Chris will bring that ordinance before council.
Absolutely.
For passage.
I didn't have any idea was the case, so.
Okay, as Brian asked me to mention earlier, so that more people would probably hear it, the first Coffee with a Cop event has been scheduled for Wednesday, November 11th from 5:30 to 7. There will be an officer at each at Dino's, the Emporium, and the Spirited Goat. So you can come and speak with the officers and get to know them a little bit. The water plant process, you have an additional handout in your packets about the water plant process. We did shortlist 4 firms out of the original 12 SOQs, and as soon as we shortlisted the 4 firms and had a site meeting, one of them dropped out because they felt that they could not provide us with an adequate design within our projected cost. So we have 3 remaining firms that will present here in this room on December the 10th starting at 6 p.m. They will be presenting before the committee as well as the rest of council members, and anyone can ask any questions of them at that time. Once they pass, once we finish those presentations, we will be opening the guaranteed maximum prices provided by each of them. Law says you cannot open those guaranteed maximum prices until after the presentations have occurred. So at a time after those presentations have occurred, the committee will meet and open those guaranteed maximum prices, and then we will bring before council a recommendation on who to let the contract to at the December 21st meeting, and that is the piece of legislation that Karen was talking about.
Patty, are there time limits that have been set up for the 10th, or how's that
working? We've set it to be, I think it's 30 minutes for a presentation and then 20 minutes of Q&A for each of them. So it is scheduled to go from 6 to 9 with a short break in between each presentation. Any other questions about that? Correct. That will not be shown live. It will be shown on a delay after all the presentations are completed. The electric rate structure, which we talked about a little bit earlier, the Energy Board did meet, did consult with John Courtney, and they are jointly recommending a rate structure, a flat rate structure, for the village. And what that means is it is a flat rate that everybody pays the same per kilowatt. And this is the best, apparently what John feels is the best rate structure for us. It's fair and equitable. No one class should unduly support another, which is kind of what we have now with our rate structure. It's a little bit inequitable for some of the middle of the road users. So if council is in agreement, I will instruct John to move forward with the flat rate design.
Yep. Sounds good.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I have 2 other things. We, on Friday, got the official notice that we have been awarded the NatureWorks grant in the amount of $22,253, and this is matching funds for the new playground equipment here on this property at the Bryan Center. We can't move forward just yet. They have to send me the contracts, which I then have to sign and send back, and then they tell us we can move forward. The other thing is this, I don't think made it into the announcements earlier. At our place tonight was the Greene County Town Hall Meeting on Mental Illness, which will be Saturday, November 7th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Greene County Educational Service Center on East Enon Road here in Yellow Springs, starting at 8:30 with a registration and complimentary continental breakfast. It is hosted by the Ohio Empowerment Coalition, TCM Behavioral Health Services, Mental Health and Recovery Board of Clark, Greene, and Madison Counties, Ohio Association of County Behavioral Authorities, and NAMI, Clark, Greene, and Madison Counties. So this is a wealth of information for you on mental health. So if you have any questions, these will be on the table out in the hall, and you can pick one up. And that's all I have.
Great. Melissa?
Basically, my report just said that I have been dealing with budget, and the two paragraphs were kind of tied into what we'd already discussed tonight, just a little blurb on House Bill 5 and why we were doing it, and that we kind of, well, we have to, so it was just in there just kind of as an informational piece about tonight. And then another informational piece about tonight's budget, basically saying that there are a couple of funds that are showing deficits that were not before, but it was just a result of the capital expenditures. So none of the expenditures and their effect on our fund balances are concerning at all. So that was just kind of a warm up to the presentations tonight. So that's it.
And Judy?
All right, I'm actually going to read some of this for once. Election eve is upon us, so I'd like to wish the very best to Marianne and Jerry. And you're actually running for a seat on council with intimate knowledge of just how difficult that is, so my sympathies and best wishes are with you. I'd also like to express appreciation to Lori Asklund for her time on council. She's been a champion for staff, for working people in general, an advocate for mental health issues, a thorough researcher on a number of complex issues which have come before council over the years. A written opinion or educational piece from Lori was sure to be comprehensive, thoughtful, balanced, and witty, and Lori will be missed.
Aww, so sweet. Thank you.
And then I have included on the reverse of the clerk report just some information that was sent in a letter to the editor at the Yellow Springs News in hopes of allaying any concerns regarding transparency in the charter amendment pieces. So that's pretty self-explanatory. And thank you, Council. In your current incarnation, I believe you've done a tremendous amount of work and initiated a great deal of positive change. May we continue forward just as readily following the outcome of the election.
Thank you. And just to be clear, as far as Lori is concerned, if the charter amendments pass, the charter amendments change the when the new council is installed to January 1. So if the charter amendments pass, Lori will be with us for three more meetings.
If not,
it's all complicated.
Yeah, it's, yes. And it just kind of fell upon us without thinking it through very clearly. So, okay, so let's look at future agenda items.
Before you do that, I don't know about Brian, but myself and Brian headed up the Charter Review Committee, and without Judy's, she signed it, without her help and so forth, with getting all the material out to the members on the committee and so forth, we would have never made it. Mm-hmm. So
it was incredibly complicated.
Kudos to Judy for the effort that she put forward in getting the document out, and then also the informational pieces.
Thank
great.
You.
So we have probably the same amount of pieces of legislation on the agenda, all of the boards and commissions. The budget, we're declaring an emergency. I think we still will do two readings. We're just doing it so it goes into effect. Let's see, the second readings of a few things. We are going to have some planning and zoning changes. So some, what are they called? What text amendments to the zoning code. There's a few of those that we will do. Then another, something else related to the tax levy that will be on the March 15th ballot, police vision statement resolution. And I also would like to add a resolution thanking Mark Roosevelt for his 5 years at Antioch College and wishing him well in his future endeavors.
Is he done at the end of this
year? At the
year?
End of the year, and there is a there's a program for him. I think that they have. I don't know that they've announced it.
Okay. Yeah.
There's a program for him on December 2nd or something that I will be taking this to. I will let him know that we'll have this resolution. If he wants to come to the November 16th meeting, he can. The other thing we need, we will have the ACE task force discussion. And we will have commission reports at the end of that.
End of the year commission reports? Or they?
No, just regular commission reports.
That's right. It's right. The annual reports we do at the beginning of the year.
Yeah, and then December 7th, budget. And that, you know, at this point, that's all that we have on there. Although we'll have the second readings of all of these text amendments for the zoning code.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
December 10th, both of the next two regular meetings will be starting at the next three regular meetings. So that's November 16th, December 7th, and December 21 will be starting at 6:30. They will all be regular sessions. Then December 10th, we have the special meeting. It starts at 6 p.m. To discuss the water plant, to hear from the water plant finalist design build. So, and as you're looking forward to January, to 2016, our first meeting is January 4th at 7 o'clock.
And I definitely won't be at that one. Well, I guess if you do something I don't approve of, I might have to throw up.
So, I will entertain a motion to go into executive session for the purpose of the evaluation of our village manager. I know that's not the correct language, is it, Chris?
I think it tells everybody what
we're doing. Okay, thank you.
I will need to have a break.
Wait.
You need a second.
So move.
So moving, yeah.
Second.
Asplund.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes.